Hello. Calm down. Here we are in the garden, and it's been rather neglected, to be honest. But that gives me a perfect opportunity to show you how to start a garden by watching me restart my garden. One thing I want to make very clear right at the beginning is that I'm not a gardening expert. I know very little about gardening. I'm a complete layperson when it comes to gardening. But that's kind of the point of what these videos are going to be about. I'm trying to make gardening accessible to everybody. Gardening, I've discovered, is a lot like cooking in that it can be incredibly elaborate, but it can be incredibly simple as well. And we're going to be working right down at the simple end. Let's take a tour around and I'll show you the layout. We've come down to the bottom corner of the garden, so hopefully you can see the four main beds. So I've got four large raised beds here, and then behind me here there's some smaller beds. I've gone over in other videos about these beds and how I established them and why they're set out like this, and also how I do my rotation. So I'll only go over that very briefly here. Basically, when I started this garden, there was no soil. The whole place where I live is shale. There's no sort of living matter in it. So in order to make a proper vegetable garden, rather than try and turn everything into soil, I just concentrated on the four beds that I'd actually be planting in. So some of this will apply as well if you're going to follow a similar sort of rotation to what I do. In the first year then, I put down loads of horse poo, and horse poo is quite handy because it's effectively less digested than something like cow manure, for instance. So cows have got loads of stomachs, they extract nearly all the nutrients out of what they eat, whereas a horse only has one stomach, and a horse is not very efficient at processing what it eats. So that means there's lots of stuff left when it poops it out. Anyway, I pile all that in a big heap and then plant squash in there. So pumpkins, butternut squash, courgettes, all that sort of thing. That will deal with stuff that's as rich as that. Then in the second year, I put potatoes into that patch. And the potatoes, they thrive on that as well. They'll also, each potato has loads of little micro roots coming off of it, which really helps break up the material. And then of course, when you dig up the potatoes, you're cultivating it even more. After that, I would chuck down some lime or wood ash to make the soil more alkaline, and then plant brassicas. And you can see there, that's where the hoops are. That was the brassicas from last season. And then in the fourth year, it's everything else. So beetroot, carrots, salads, all that kind of stuff. And then in the fifth year, we start again. So the way that works with the four beds then is I'd simply move up one stage each year. This is what happens then if you just abandon a bed after harvest. I've gone and created myself quite a bit of work there. On the other hand, this is what happens when you cover something up. So this bed was completely covered with these old tin sheets, and all the weeds just died away, and it'll just require a little poking over and we're good to go. In what was the brassica bed, it's just some husks of old calabres there. It should be, at this time of year, purple sprouting broccoli, and there should still be some kale on the go. But I completely failed to plant those out in time last year, so yeah. So I've shown you the four main beds, and that's where most of the action happens. The other really important component of the garden is this polytunnel. Now, like the beds, this polytunnel has also seen better days. I have a new cover for it. Obviously I haven't fitted it yet. So this is one of the cheap ones you can get. I think this came from an eBay supplier. They're all over eBay and Amazon. Lots of different brands. I suspect they all come from the same factory. This particular one This particular one is 2 meters in that direction by 4 meters long, and that's about the right size for me. This cost, I can't remember how much it cost, I think it was between 70 and 90, something like that, pounds. It's about 4 or 5 years old now, and this cover held up well for about 3 years. The replacement cover I've got should be better than that, but it's not fitted, which is going to make it kind of interesting to fit. It's just a massive sheet that I'm going to have to, you know, kind of wrap around this frame, but we'll get into that in due course. This is obviously the chicken house. It's one of those igloo things which are a bit plasticky and gimmicky for my liking. It was a present, I didn't buy it myself. I have to admit though, they are brilliant for being fox-proof. The whole design of it makes it pretty much impenetrable for predators, which is great. They are funny little creatures, bantams. They're great fun. They've got quite good little personalities. The great thing about them is that they don't, because they're so small, they don't tear up the garden like real chickens would. So they can just bimble about and do their thing, and it's all good. I do have to make sure that I don't, if I'm direct sowing stuff like carrots and things like that, I will put a mesh on so that they can't just dig it up, because they love that sort of thing. Especially, strangely enough, spring onions. They'll nibble them down all the way down, and then they'll dig up the bulbs and eat those as well. But I found if I grow on seedlings, which they do in the polytunnel there, and in pots, and once they're bursting out the pots, then I plant them out, the chickens will just scratch around them and they won't dig them up. So we've learned to accommodate each other on that. This is one of the drawbacks of having bantams. Every now and again, I decide they want to keep the eggs. Start smashing them somewhere. Yeah, found you. What's happening there is that at some point one of the chickens has gone to lay an egg. Another chicken is already laying an egg in the igloo. So that chicken's gone to find somewhere else. And then in subsequent days has gone back to that place to lay the eggs. That's why there's a whole bunch of eggs in there. And just one at a time appearing in the igloo. All right, let's calm down. Yep, we happy? Okay. I used to have a whole bunch of chickens, 6 or so I think, and they had a little wooden chicken house on stilts, which was over in the top corner of the garden, and on the other side of the fence was the dog house, and that was a completely foolproof system. So the chicken house was open, there were no doors in it, the chickens were completely free range, they could let themselves out in the morning, put themselves away at night. But because the dog slept next door to them, he was on permanent guard. And that was great. Yeah. Unfortunately that system fell apart when the dog died, and that's when I brought the igloo back into use. These smaller beds are for more specialist things. In the bottom there, I've got garlic on the go, so still quite a bit of that going. This one's strawberries, although they look to have died right back. And in this one here is where I tend to use this as a tree nursery. So I grow on seedlings in there until they're big enough to go and plant out in the woodland. And you can probably just about make out behind the polytunnel is a little shed which just holds the tools and the chicken feed. Like many of you then, I've placed a big order for loads of seeds. It hasn't arrived yet, but while I'm waiting, I can start tidying up these beds and replace the cover on the polytunnel. Now I'm a bit limited in my digging capability because of my poor internals. I can only dig for not very long at a time. I'll probably do it in half bed stages. So yeah, bit by bit, steady does it. So when it comes to gardening, there's two types of digging. Well, I mean, this is just my take on it. There's digging with a spade, where you're actually digging into the soil and inverting it, and that's the equivalent of a farmer ploughing his field. So you think of a plough goes through the earth and turns it over. The other type of is to use a fork and just fork it and then break it up like that, and that's the equivalent of a farmer rotivating the field. Or of course you can indeed rotivate a garden. Part of the appeal to me of making the raised bed system like this is it's quite a lot of work to begin with, but once you're putting in the horse poo, most of the work is done by all the creatures that live in the soil and by the plants growing there. So there's no need to dig over it each time. What I'll do is just go over with a fork and pull out all the obvious weeds. I do on a couple of the beds have a bit of an invasion of bindweed, so I'll go through it and pull out the roots of that, and then I leave those roots in the sun and they die off. But yeah, there's no need to actually properly dig in and flip it over and do all that kind of stuff, which is just as well, because that's not something I'm good at. Like many of us, I think, I wish I'd ordered the seeds months ago, but ayo. One thing I have done though is got hold of some sea potatoes. I've got a main crop here and some secondaries there. I think this will be enough. So with sea potatoes, they want to sprout really quite a bit before you plant them. It gives them a bit of a head start. You might be able to make out these are just about sprouting. So I'm going to lay them all out in these trays, and I'll put them indoors in the living room where it's fairly warm, and help get them on their way. You might be wondering why you're supposed to buy sea potatoes and why can't you just plant normal potatoes, because I'm sure we've all had potatoes stored a little bit too long in the cupboard and they start sprouting. And you can plant those and they will grow and it'll probably be alright for a bit, but the trouble is potatoes are very prone to disease, and so as I understand it, the sea potatoes are grown high up. These ones are from Scotland, so they're grown at a high altitude, and then they can be guaranteed to be free of any disease. That's just my vague recollection of the reasons. Anyway, here we are. So I'm handing them a bit delicately, just so I don't break any of these sprouts, shoots rather. I'm going to leave the bag on top so I don't forget which ones they are. There we go. You can see there, they're just on their way. There'll be more of those coming out, and I want them to be about that long before I plant them out. Now, here's a top tip for gardening. All the good stuff is normally on the packet. So like all the packets of seeds that you get, there's a full set of instructions on the back. So it really is foolproof. It says here they can be sprouted out in shallow trays in a light, frost-free place until planting. Planting can take place as soon as the risk of frost has passed, which we're on the cusp of that at the moment. And then we'll get on to the planting when I plant them out, and then this is about earthing them up and then harvesting them. These ones, which are the second earlies, should be ready from June to September. So I'm just planting out second earlies and main crop. I don't have any early earlies. So if you've seen a few of my videos, you'll know that I generally work alone, but not always. Project Awesome, for instance, is very much a team effort with my friend Mark. And this garden, at least this year, is going to be a team effort with my friend Becky. I'll just say at this juncture, because people are bound to wonder, Becky's not my girlfriend. And I'm saying that for her sake as much as anything else, because she hates it when people make that assumption. So Becky's not my girlfriend in the same way that Mark is not my boyfriend. Both of them are friends that I happen to collaborate with occasionally. Becky is, though, the nearest friend that I have, so it is a very short journey for her to make to come here. So that's part of the reason we think it's an acceptable thing to do. As I film this, it's right at the beginning of April, and I've been in isolation for the last 2 weeks, and Becky and her young son have been the same. So we feel that it's safe to work together, although we're still going to maintain the 2 meter distancing as much as we can. But that's something we do anyway, to be honest. It's going to be an opportunity for them to get out in the fresh air and have some, not just exercise, but do something useful. And also they're going to have, obviously, their share of the produce. It means that I don't have to do all the digging, which is, like I said before, something I'm not great at. Becky also knows a great deal about gardening, so hopefully she can bring some of that information and I can spread it out to you lot. I think it'll also do us both a lot of good to just to be able to interact with another human being at relatively close range. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not lonely here, and I've had an enormous amount of support from all you people out there in YouTube land, and that's it's been almost overwhelming at times, to be honest, but it's hugely appreciated. So yes, a massive thank you to everybody that's written in, commented positively on my videos, and even sent me money, placed orders, emailed me. It's all hugely appreciated, so thank you all for that. There's too many to thank individually, but just know that I appreciate all of you for that. Thank you. At the moment then, the garden really doesn't look like much at all. But there was a time, not very long ago, when this was producing an enormous amount of vegetables, and it will again, this year in fact. So stick with me and you can watch me make that happen. Well, I hope that little introduction's been of some interest at least. These are not going to be epically exciting videos, but if people want me to make them, then I will. Hopefully there'll be some tips in as I go along that you can pick up and use in your own garden. The main thing I want to get across is that gardening, it's easy peasy. The basic gardening is such an easy thing. As my mum said, plants want to grow. So unlike anything else that you might do, like woodwork or metalwork, where you're constantly struggling against the thing, the plants really want to, you know, do that for you. Obviously, some of the plants that want to grow aren't necessarily the ones that you want to grow, but, you know. It's an easy thing to do. And what I find, the type of gardening that I do, it takes a fair bit of effort to get it underway. And then after that, I tend to do 10 minutes an evening, sort of here and there, not even every evening. And it just sort of ticks along like that. So I don't, you know, set aside a whole day to go and do weeding or something like that. Just potter about. And if you potter about and keep on top of it, it just grows and grows, and you'll have tons of stuff. Anyway, that'll do for now. Stay safe, everybody, and I'll see you in the next one. Cheers.